Today on the show, I am chatting with Dr. Dirk Van Tuerenhout, a curator of anthropology at the Houston Museum of Natural Science. Dirk and I talk about his childhood in Belgium, his love affair with the Maya and the Aztec, the lure of the Big Easy, and a little lady named Lucy and her connection to my pup. So stay tuned. Hi, everyone. This is Sandy Adams, and you're listening to a Southern Girls View podcast. Dirk, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me. A pleasure to see you.
I'm going to let you say your full name because I was having some issues pronouncing it.
My last name is Van Tuerenhout. Dirk, yes. Is fine. As I always
you always make me think when I say your name, I always think about there's a writer. He always does these adventure novels and I can't think of his name. But I always, when every time I hear your name, I always think about an adventure novel.
Oh, well, there you go. All right. I hope they're good adventures.
Yes, they are. So a little bit for people out there of how we know each other. We met through a group that I was affiliated with, Archaeology Now, and I've known you now for 3 or 4 years, and we've had some fun adventures, interesting people, great dinner conversations.
Indeed, we have.
All kinds of things like that. So let's talk about your current job and what exactly it is officially and what your role is in the museum.
So I'm a curator of anthropology at the Houston Museum of Natural Science. And the word curator sounds very fancy, but you can see there's a root in there to take care of. And that means I'm not taking care of people directly. I'm taking care of artifacts made by people. And so what we have in our collections, especially in anthropology, is all kinds of material stuff. And that's a technical term.
Right.
Where the museum build a collection where we have evidence of people making a mask for a reason or a pot for a reason. They don't always have to be King Tut's gold mask, of course. Right. We have a wide range geographically and chronologically in the museum on display in our Egypt Hall and also in our Hall of the Americas. But we have a lot more not on display, and that goes for every single curator, in our collections building. That is a typical scenario for any museum where we have but a very small percentage of items, or in the case of biology, say butterflies or birds, what have you, specimens,
right,
on display versus not on display. So I am involved with the collections. I have my office in, when things are normal, I have my office in the separate building with my colleagues and the entire staff, just about the entire staff of the collections department,
right,
which I'm a part of. And that's in a different building away from the museum. And we not only select items to go on display as curators, but we, mm-hmm, also take care with colleagues, because we're not doing this by ourselves.
Right.
Take care of the collections, input them into the database. And that's where a lot of other smart people come in that do it the way it should be done versus me scratching my head. So it's a teamwork, I keep emphasizing. And then we also work with incoming exhibits, traveling shows that we haven't put together, but that are related to the field, say, of anthropology. So I keep telling people when they ask what you do at the museum, every day is different. It's never the same routine. You get emails. Again, this is more referring to quote-unquote normal times.
Right.
But even now, schools are in session in a sense. They're all at home, and parents get an appreciation of what teachers do, by the way.
Yes.
You all know that. But so there might be people who are asking questions about certain topics they're researching. So we are trying the best we can to be part of the community, all the curators, the entire museum in a sense. But we sort of provide content as much as we can. And so our job as curators is very broad and varied and never dull.
So one thing that I think some people out there may get confused at is what exactly, it's the Museum of Natural History, but how is that different from other, like, because I know some artifacts
sure,
can go over into different categories. So how, explain the natural history part and what that is.
Well, we have, for those who don't know the museum, because with the broadcast here, we can reach Alaska, right? So there might be people watching who have not been to the Houston Museum Natural Science. So we are kind of like, on a smaller scale, a museum that people might know better, the American Museum of Natural History in New York, right. The one where everybody, you know, died at the museum, that kind of stuff. So we have dinosaurs, which you won't find at a fine art museum, last time I checked. You might have a painting of a dinosaur, but that's as close as you're going to get. So we have the natural world present inside the museum, which means dinosaurs, yes, but our dinosaur hall takes the story from the very beginning of life all the way to us. And so there you start seeing where archaeology comes in and anthropology, the study of human beings, comes in, because at the end of the story, our ancestors show up. And that's important. We are part of the world. We are living on this world. And so we have dinosaurs. We have wildlife, Texas wildlife, African wildlife. We have minerals, beautiful mineral hall. So the whole picture, if you want, is one in which we operate and we are part of.
Right.
And that is where we are different from art museums, or for obvious reasons, very close, for those who know Houston, within a few blocks of the museum are other museums. There's a children's museum. Well, that's little patooties. That's little human beings. And so that is their mission. We also have the Holocaust Museum. So there's another aspect of human existence that is being treated there respectfully and in depth. And that is their bailiwick and not ours. Ours is more, who were the people that lived at one point in time and made the artifacts we're about to see, as in the Hall of the Americas, or next door, really, Egypt, ancient Egypt.
Okay. So, and we mentioned briefly about, obviously, the museum is closed right now.
Yes.
And you are working from home. How has the pandemic impacted your job currently? And I did see on the website that it says that you guys are going to open back up in May.
We are looking at that for sure. Nobody knows exactly. Right. There's all kinds of other people involved in making the decision. Every museum, and people can look this up, the museum world is hard hit, as is the rest of the community. We are hopeful that we can open sooner rather than later.
Right.
But all of that has to be done safely
for
obvious reasons. And so there's a lot of preparation that has to go into it. And that is currently what other museum colleagues are working on.
Right.
I am working from home, and my job allows me to work on computer. A lot of people can do this now by plugging in through the computer to the main computers at your work, a place of work. So in my case, I can pull up data from the servers at the museum, and I can continue my job. And at this point, I'm working on the renovation of the Hall of the Americas.
Oh.
So I have my books here at home. I'm a book fiend, so I'm surrounded by tons of books. So I have my backup, and then of course you can go online. So I can, with the help of my colleagues, because we email each other and we find out, can you do this for me? Can you do that? And again, smarter people can find stuff for me online, like, they don't use French words, but it's getting close. Like, come on, it's right here. And they give me a link, and I find it, and then I move forward. And so that is, in my case, a blessing. There are people who cannot do this. They have to physically go outside and perform, or else cannot, and stay home and or are not working.
So how is it being in the house? Is your wife there currently with you quarantining?
Yes, and our daughter.
Have y'all had any issues, like any squabbles, any?
No, we are sort of compartmentalized. And our daughter, just as a personal note, she was actually studying abroad. Mm-hmm. We are happy she's back home. We're sad she had to cut that experience midway through. She was in Europe and she had to come back for obvious reasons. And so she is continuing her classes from home.
Right.
That was exciting, but there we go. It's safe. She's with us.
Now, where was she studying abroad at?
She was in Barcelona.
Barcelona. And she's still a student at
Vanderbilt.
At Vanderbilt. That's right.
Just down the road from the University of Memphis.
That's right. I want to give a shout out to my home state. Yes.
That's right. Yeah.
And I was really excited.
What, about 2 hours away, I think, right? just about? Or two and a half?
From Memphis, it's about three hours. About 3 hours, depending on how fast you drive.
Of course. Yes.
so let's, you mentioned earlier about people emailing you for help with research. So how can parents at home use the HMNS, the museum website, to help enrich like the studies that their kids are doing right now?
The website, well, there might be information available through the, but things are changing as well, but we've had previous exhibits so people can look things up that way. In the case of, and I will just give out my email and people can email me, and if it's something related to plants, I'll forward it to somebody else. And it's my first name, D-I-R-K, at hmns.org.
Okay, I'll make sure I put that in the show notes.
Right,
too.
So my email address is a four-letter word. I keep joking about it. But the website does also provide, and this is a little plug for the gift shop, a lot of people doing homeschooling, obviously.
Right.
And so the museum gift shop has packages, has all kinds of educational materials that people can look up through the website and see if there's anything that relates to astronomy or chemistry, things that we as a science museum cover.
Right.
And then I will slide it over to my colleagues in the gift shop, who then can take care of the orders. And I know that there are people coming in who will look at the emails, take care of the orders, put them in boxes and ship them out to the parents who are looking for, there's always stuff they need to have for the kids. And all of a sudden, this kind of jumped on people, right? All of a sudden school is over. What? Now what?
Right. Do you think that what's happening right now will change how the museum addresses education maybe in the future? Well, do you think it'll make you guys look at maybe putting more stuff online where parents can access it easier or students can, and look at how you can be not just an in-person museum, but maybe also help with the digital and reach more people that way?
And that's a very good question. I think you're right. A lot of museums are moving in that direction by default at this point, but also I'm sure they will have a legacy afterwards in that once the work is done, it would make sense to preserve what you have done on your website.
Right.
If you want to know more about A to Z, astronomy to zoology, we will have, I'm sure, contributions put on our webpage, which, by the way, as you know, is hmns.org.
That's right. That's right.
Also, continue afterwards to maintain it and keep adding to it. Mm-hmm. Still, of course, emphasizing for those who can, and when times are normal, please do come visit us, because in-person experience is incredible.
Yes.
But otherwise, in terms of resources, I personally enjoy at this point the luxury and not privilege, because everybody can do it. You can go online with other museums, and we are working towards that goal, but we're not quite there yet. But we can access, in the case of other museums, their collections. We can look at, so I can look things up that I'm researching that might be available online at other museums. Well, we are trying to get there. It takes a lot of time. You get to appreciate how much time went into the web pages of these other museums. And so you want to do it right. And so eventually we'll get there. We have the software, we're working on it. It's a big team that is doing this in the same building I'm stationed at. So thousands and thousands of shells and lots of artifacts. So you can imagine this is not done with a magic wand happening overnight. But once that is done, to your question, there will be an additional component there for people who are either homeschooling or just interested to go to the museum's website and look up content in that regard as well. So more and more we're heading that way as a complement to the in-person visit at the museum.
I interviewed Dr. Sushma Jansari on Thursday, and I asked her about her visit here in Houston and what had she been looking forward to seeing, or what was one of the things she really enjoyed seeing. Your museum was on her list.
Wow.
And she said one of the things was that she really wanted to see the dinosaurs there, and she was just amazed at them. So it definitely is. In person can never take the place of online, and just, you know, especially seeing kids go in and just seeing the wonder of everything.
That's right. And especially we can look at a video on computer. We can look at pictures of a dinosaur on computer, But when you walk into the museum on our second floor balcony into the new hall, it's just a very small portion of our second floor extends into, as you know, into the second, into the new wing. And it's like you're looking literally from a balcony into, I'm not going to say Jurassic Park, but this is a size, a space that has a ceiling, which is this the third floor. It's the floor of the third floor. The ceiling is where the third floor starts, because right. we have these very long necked dinosaurs that yes. need their space.
That's right.
So it's a little bit bigger than your computer screen, even for the Texans among us. Right. We don't have computer screens that big that can accommodate a two-story dinosaur. So in person is always, yes, much better.
So let's move back to when you were little. Where did you grow up at?
Well, I grew up with a name like mine. You might say, well, that guy's from Texas, but you might have picked up A, an accent, and B, the name is not Texan. So I'm from Belgium, land of chocolate and beer and diamonds.
That's right.
On the other side of the pond, so to speak. So I grew up in a small town. At the time, I thought it was a big one, called Mechelen or Malines. It's 25 kilometers north of Brussels, the capital. Everything in Belgium is rather small, so another 75 kilometers, certainly 75 miles, and you were in a different country.
Right.
Anyway, I went to school, primary school and secondary school there, and eventually went to university in a different city about another 25 kilometers away, and then moved on.
Did you always want to be in the profession that you are in now when you were little? Is that what you wanted to do?
Well, I can honestly say it's the fault slash to the credit of a teacher in sixth grade in my elementary school. So the last year, we don't have the layers of primary school and middle school and high school. It's different. It's primary school from 6 to 12, and then we move on to secondary school, which is 12 to 18, and then you go to university or vocational school, trade school. Okay. So in my case, it was the last year of the elementary school experience I had. And it's one of those, in those days, where I had teachers who had taught my dad. Can you imagine that?
Oh, wow.
They were all much younger than at the time, of course, but they remembered my dad. Anyway, so it's one of those more, it's a school that was totally, had sunk its roots in the community. And that meant a lot, because the teacher in sixth grade really made us appreciate those roots of the community in time. Right. And so one of the things he did, and that's the reason I got interested in all things old, archaeology, history, is that he divided the class, and I cannot remember, I think it was, we were about 20 to 25 students in the class. And he was the only teacher. Well, there was a few PE teacher, and there was a religion teacher, but otherwise it was him teaching the class. And so he divided us in small groups, so maybe groups of four or five. He all gave us a name of a medieval guild. So there was the group of the barrel makers and the brewers and the shoemakers. So we all had a little tag.
Right.
And we all got on a sheet of paper questions that we had to answer as a group. Not with everybody else. It was just within group, and it was a competition. We went into a city, which was another 3 miles away. And so go to visit old buildings. We have history going back 1,000, 1,500 years easily. And then in the museums, we go back to prehistoric times.
Right.
And so we had to look around, and he had gone around and asked the staff if that was okay for us to come. You can walk into churches, of course, and look at things and answer questions that he put together. But they were not straightforward questions. They were questions aimed at making us look at things.
Right.
And so sometimes you felt, as a 12-year-old, you felt very cocky. And you're like, well, that's easy. And you answered it, and he goes, no, you didn't read the question right, or you didn't look at the thing right. And so because of that, I got an appreciation for the very rich history of the city I grew up in. And by the way, everybody is aware of this famous, they call him a Spanish emperor, but he was not. He was a Flemish boy like me. Carlos V or Charles V, the emperor of the Spanish Empire, in whose empire the sun never set. The one that was sort of involved with the conquest in Mexico as well later on. So he grew up in my hometown. And so there are statues here and there. If only you know where to look. And sometimes you have to look up. And as most people do, you're just busy every day. You're going to school, you're going to the store, you're going to work, and you look forward in front of you. You never look around. And he taught us how to look and see and appreciate. And so that got me interested. He hooked me. And I was, as an aside, teachers are important. And again, homeschooling parents realize that today. Yes. And so I was happy and lucky and blessed to be able to let him know that he made a difference in my life.
What did your dad do? What was your dad's
profession? Was an accountant. So very different. Oh. Yes. And so
that's funny.
Yeah, in a way. But both my parents were in the accounting business. My mom, in the end, I have three siblings, so she was stayed home to raise my younger siblings.
Right.
But she still helped out my dad. But at the same time, to their credit, and again, this is up to every individual parent. Mm-hmm. But in my case, they were very supportive of me pursuing a field of study where other parents might say, well, you're going to find a job with that. And that's a legit question. I would argue it's a legit question for just about any field of study. But in the case of my parents, it was like, well, if you want to do that, go ahead. We'll support you.
That's really good. So you did go to post, what do you call it? You did get degrees there in Belgium, but then you ended up at Tulane in New Orleans.
That's right.
Where you got, I believe, a master's and a PhD?
Yes.
So let's talk about why would a boy from Belgium want to come to the Big Easy in the United States? Like, what was that connection there?
The connection was pre-Columbian studies. In other words, fancy word for Maya, Aztec, Inca.
Which most people would not associate with New Orleans, I don't think.
Maybe not, but let me enlighten you. So Tulane University has had, almost for 100 years now, a very long, storied past in the study of specifically the Maya, to some degree other cultures, and especially these days, everywhere else in what is called Mesoamerica, which is another fancy word, which really means central Mexico all the way down to Central America, and then further south in the Andean regions, in Peru and neighboring countries. But Tulane has had a very long history through the anthropology department and another institute called the Middle American Research Institute. And that tells you Middle American. We're talking Southern Mexico, Yucatan Peninsula, and then Guatemala, Belize, and all of that. Researching in the old days on mules and you know, going through the jungle, just like sort of everybody says that, you know, Indiana Jones hacking their way through the jungle. But because of that, there's a very rich history, lots of publications. And so it's a good library, one of the best Latin American libraries in the United States. And so if you're interested in studying that particular geographic area in that particular slice of time, all the way up to pre-Hispanics or pre-contact before the Europeans show up, and that really means 1519-ish for the mainland, 1521 if you're an Aztec, 1597 if you're a Maya in one case. That means you go study at, among others, there are other good schools too, but Tulane is one of them. And so as it goes in the United States, you apply.
Right.
Very different from Europe, because back home I went to the Catholic University of Louvain, and any university back home, if you can afford the, at the time, very low but still sizable tuition, which was the equivalent in those days, and this was a while ago, was $300 for a whole year.
Oh my God.
And then that's it. Very different. Just to give you
very different
comparison, I also applied to other schools, and I was admitted but couldn't afford to go to UCLA.
Right.
Because at the time, and this is my parents were paying the $300 to go for me to go to the university in Louvain. At that time, out of state, granted that's higher, out of state tuition for UCLA was 9,000.
Wow. That's
so
a bit, that's,
you know, huge. Today people will be quote unquote happy to pay the 9,000 to go to a school in UCLA, because it's a lot more nowadays. And so I was lucky. I applied to schools, and I was lucky that at Tulane, which had all the right background, they gave me the full ride. Otherwise, I would not have been able to do it.
What was it like going to school in New Orleans?
Well,
especially from a guy that's from another country.
Sure.
Like, what was that experience like there?
For starters, the city has a lot of history, so that's cool. It's not to say that I was going into the French Quarter to find my roots every single day, because that was not exactly what I was interested in. I was diving into the Latin American library because back home, those books were, couldn't find them. Right. But otherwise, imagine for those who live along the Gulf Coast, it's about every day, 200% humidity.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And hot and steamy. And so it's the same in New Orleans as it is in Houston, as it is anywhere along the Gulf Coast. So you went to class. The campus is small, so I walked.
And it's a beautiful campus.
Yes, it's in a part of the city close to the park and Audubon Zoo. And so there's a lot of old live oak trees, and the streetcar goes by. So there is, you hear the chiming of the bell and everything. But I would walk. I have my umbrella, my London fog umbrella. I had a Texas raincoat, a duster. I felt like, Clint Eastwood. And I had rubber boots from home. And I would walk to class.
And I just want to stop one sec. How tall are you? Because that's an interesting picture in my head.
6'3".
Okay.
So with boots, I guess there's another half an inch or an inch there. But I would walk to class. And I stayed to some degree protected from the elements. But then once you get there, it might take 20 minutes to get to the other side of campus. you would have to climb, I think 3 or 4 sets of stairs in this old building to go to class, for example, in the Middle American Research Institute, take my archaeology classes.
Right.
And so the place looked like a place that, and it has changed now post-Katrina, but at the time it didn't. It was basically the way it looked in 1910, I believe, when it was built. So it looked like a place you would put in a museum itself. Mm-hmm. And it smelled like one too, as they say. And so it was kind of musty, and you had to work your way all the way up. And the very last set of stairs was a doorway in a obviously an opening in the wall, and then you turn and there was this tunnel. You had to go up. It was a very narrow set of stairs all the way up. There was light at the end of the tunnel, but you ended up in the museum part of the fourth floor, which was the Middle American Research Institute, and it had a classroom at the very end. And so you would go in and then basically, somewhere put your duster down, which was just completely covered in raindrops, but these dusters are sort of oily, so they repel the water. But now you are sitting in a classroom. You put your umbrella up against the side, and then you start taking notes. But it's Houston, it's New Orleans, sorry, and it's hot and humid.
Right.
And it's a very high ceiling, and it had these things called fans. They made noise. They didn't move the air. It was just
yeah.
And so you started sweating. And so I started bringing towels to class, and people laughed at me because I was sweating. Yeah. And my thermostat adjusted over time. Right. But at the very beginning, it was so hot and humid. It was quite an experience, but I enjoyed it because I was listening to people teaching a subject matter I really, really wanted to learn more about. And so right. I was happy and lucky and blessed to be able to do that.
Right. Let's talk about your excavations in Belgium, because you've done at least one there. Am I making you sweat now?
No, it's just I get verklempt when I talk to you.
Okay.
No, I'm just kidding. It's allergies. But
oh, whatever. Yeah, allergies. Like, I've been horrible with allergies, too.
Yeah. So when I was back in Belgium, I was part of, it was a requirement, and that is true for schools here in the United States, field experience, studied history and also archaeology. And so you would have to have some field experience. And I went as part of a group of students to, quote unquote, the other side of the country, right, which was probably about 150 miles away, close in, as they say, Flanders fields, close to the border with France and close to the channel. And so these are, well, the whole country is called, as is Holland and Northern France, the Low Countries. It's very flat, mm-hmm, kind of like anywhere along the Gulf Coast. So I feel at home in New Orleans too. Everything's flat.
Right.
So I could, that's home. But so back there, we were excavating in a cow pasture. Very exciting. But a cow pasture on top of a Roman farm, a villa, which of course at the time of the Romans was standing. And it was a part of an operation that produced grain that was harvested and then sent by ships across the channel to the Roman army in what is now the UK.
Right.
And so they were growing supplies to support the Roman army. There were churches very close by in the community, very old churches, going back maybe to 1100, 1200, still standing, still in business. And when you looked at the walls, you could see the roof tiles that had come off the old Roman building.
Oh, wow.
That were used in the very thick layers of cement or mortar to keep the stones together. Mm-hmm. And they just filled them in with some, you could see these curved orange outlines, and those were bits and pieces of what they had rescued / taken out, mined from the old Roman building. And so we were there for about a month excavating in the summer in the very hot temperatures. It was probably about 70. Can you imagine that?
Yeah.
That's just unbelievable.
So now you've also excavated in Belize and Guatemala.
Right.
What were just a couple of the excavations you've done down there, and how are those different from, like, in the processes from Belgium?
Archaeology in general, of course, no matter where you go, is the same in that your goal is to answer questions. Mm-hmm. Who lived there? What can we find? It involves selecting areas where you excavate. You never have enough people to excavate an entire building, because in the first place, you might not even know how big the building is.
Right.
For starters. The differences would be that in Belize and later on in Guatemala especially, you have this thing called a jungle, which we don't have back home.
It might
be that it has been a week since you cut the lawn, mowed the lawn, so then you call that a jungle back home, but otherwise, not the same. So it's more difficult, and it's different to find the outlines of structures you might want to excavate.
Right.
In the case of Belgium, it was fairly easy, relatively speaking, to know what was there because of written sources, going back to the times of the monks who saw these Roman buildings and described them. So we knew they were there. In the case of Maya, and that's what I did in Belize and in Guatemala, you would have to do mapping exercises first, or surveying. And I was part of a surveying team in Guatemala. I did not have to do that in a sense in Belize. I was part of, as a graduate student, I was part of a group of students excavating at a site that was very well known and demarcated. Right. And people had excavated in over the years. So we knew where things were. And the professor decided this season, this particular spring, we're going to work on that building and that building. And that's it. And for these reasons, and he taught us, and that was really cool. And so I worked with a group of, I got my first experiences there as an archaeology student in the heat and humidity, also again of Belize, with different creepy crawlies, including watch out for those snakes at night when you go to the bathroom. You know, Mother Nature calls, what are you going to do, right? So we didn't have that issue either, by the way, in Belgium. No snakes when you go inside a classroom, because we would stay in schools with sleeping bags. You just walk down the corridor and go to the school's bathroom, and no snakes.
Wow.
Wow. But all of that, not to say, I enjoyed the experiences on both sides of the ocean.
So let's talk now about one of my favorite topics. So when I was about 16 years old, my sister gave me a book about a skeleton called Lucy.
Yeah.
And I just, the weird nerd in me just kind of fell in love with that. So we had an exhibit here at the museum a few years ago called Lucy's Legacy, and you were a huge part of that. Can you talk about who Lucy is? And by the way, my dog is actually named after the skeleton.
No way.
Yes.
So she lives on.
Yes, she does. Could you talk about who Lucy is, why she's important, and what your involvement was in that whole process?
Lucy, needless to say, it refers to an early possible human ancestor. Needless to say, that was not her real name. We have no idea what she was called.
Right.
She lived in what is now Ethiopia, which did not exist when she was alive, which was about 3.2 million years ago, give or take. She is known among the specialists as an Australopithecus afarensis. And that's where, having studied Greek and Roman and Latin, it helps a little bit. Australo really means south. Pithecus means ape. And afarensis is another way of saying from the region of Afar. So it's a funky way, in my opinion, but there you go. Labels were given, labels were retained. The southern ape of the Afar region of what is now Ethiopia. But that's way too long. And so a lot of fossils, especially famous ones that are fairly complete, and in her case, 40% more or less of her skeleton was preserved, they get nicknames. And right. So there are others. There is one in South Africa known as Littlefoot. There's a story there. I mean, there's so many nicknames. The Nutcracker is another one. And it doesn't refer to downtown events in the theaters. It's, right. you know, another fossil. So in 1974, Donald Johansson, a professor based in the United States in Arizona, was part of, I was actually leading a team, I believe, and they went back to a region they had found some animal remains before. And it's kind of like fishing, and that's just my interpretation. If you know that over there or over there, fish tend to bite, you might go back next week and see if they bite, if they're still biting. Right. And so in this case, they wanted to go back to see if Mother Nature had exposed through rain or wind layers that were buried last year, but might not be exposed this year. And right. so they went back. And the way he told the story was, they got out of, at one point, out of the vehicle, and he jumped out, and a lot of people jumped out. And I think it was towards the end of the day as they were going back to camp. And he happened to look in a certain direction, and the sun was reflecting off an arm bone that was partially sticking out of the ground. And it caught his eye, and he knew his bones, and right. he realized this is not a non-human bone. This is an early human ancestor bone.
Right.
So, and so that led to eventually the discovery of the other 40% of what made up Lucy. Now, Lucy, at that point, got her name because they had a party that night, as I'm
That's
sure the
right.
book told you.
Yes.
And everybody was very happy, and they played a song called Lucy in the Sky with
That's
Diamonds.
Right. That's right.
And the name stuck, according to the stories we read and heard. And so Lucy it was. She eventually, fairly on, early on, made it to the States, and this is in the 70s, to be studied, but not displayed.
Right.
And then returned to Ethiopia, where she was kept safe in the National Museum in Addis Ababa, the capital. And then in the early 2000s, I'm fast forwarding the story here to the next episode. I'm in my office, and a lot of my stories, as I'm sure you've heard me say before, start with the sentence, and then the phone rang.
And then the phone rang, yes.
And then the phone rang. And so I got an inquiry from somebody on the other side of the phone saying, we're calling from the Texas Department of Tourism in Austin. The people who came up with Texas, it's like a whole lot of country, tagline. Mm-hmm. And so she asked me all kinds of questions. Do you have archaeology exhibits? Yes, we do. How many people come? Well, that depends on how long we have the show here and how right. interested people are, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. And then the question, the next question was, and do people stay overnight? Well, ma'am, I don't ask those kinds of questions when they inquire. Besides, I don't sell the tickets, so I hardly right. ever really come in touch with, in contact with people at the very beginning when they're planning the trip. I might right. see them in the show. But anyway, and I asked her at that point, what is this all about? And then she mentioned there is a possibility of an exhibit coming in from Ethiopia to Texas, to Houston, possibly, and it involves Miss Lucy. And that was the extent of her knowledge of Miss Lucy.
Right.
So I don't know if she knew that Miss Lucy was long gone and no longer with us, or Miss Lucy was a famous Ethiopian movie star.
Right.
I don't know. But I asked her, is there anybody else that I could ask for more information? And it so happens that we have still have the same gentleman in town who is the Ethiopian consul.
That's
representative,
right.
diplomatic representative for Ethiopia. And so I reached out to him, and he explained that it was not a movie star, but right. almost as famous, and that it was the fossil that the Ethiopian government had made available to travel as part of an exhibit on the history of Ethiopia. So it was not just going to be human evolution. It was Christianity, Islam, right. Judaism, you name it, the emperor, Haile Selassie, Rastafarianism, you name it, a lot of right. history there.
Right.
And then we put together a program, as in like a storyline that we thought would encompass all these sort of requirements that the government was looking for. Can you do this? Can you address that? We traveled with colleagues for many years, once a year, over to Ethiopia to meet with people from the university in Addis and other universities. We flew around the country because it's a really big country.
Right.
And into the mountains to go see a place where they claim they keep the Ark of the Covenant, which of course nobody can see.
Right.
The priest came out and blessed us, so we feel
really
good about that. Anyway, so an incredible experience, all because at one point the phone rang.
Right.
Before you know it, the storyline, as we call it, our proposal, this is how we would like to represent the country with objects coming from your museums, because needless to say, our museum doesn't have an awful lot of material from Ethiopia.
Right.
We would like to represent your country in a certain way, and here it is with the artifacts identified, and they say, yes, let's do it. This is a few years after the phone rang, and so eventually Lucy made her grand debut.
She did. Were you excited when you first got to see her?
Unbelievable, yes. I mean, this is, okay, so you know, we just talked a little bit about my background. I went to old Catholic churches in Belgium, and they're like 1,000 years old. That's decent, right?
Right.
And in museums where you could see a Bronze Age canoe, and so now you're talking a few thousand years more. But that's European history, and there's nothing wrong with that. And then you study a little bit of Egyptian and a little bit of Greek and Roman. Fine. And then you come over because I'm interested in Maya and Aztec. And next thing I know, I was familiar with Lucy because when I was at Tulane, I was also taking classes. And that's a different aspect of education. In the United States, you study archaeology as part of anthropology. So you take classes in physical anthropology, which is bones and human evolution. So I had the privilege of studying with a really good professor, and I became her TA for at least 1 year. So I got to understand human evolution much better, courtesy of her classes that I took or assisted with. And so, you know, I was sort of, fate was pushing me in that direction, I guess. And so when I finally got to see the real fossil, which is not on display, was not then, still not now. It was in Houston and it was in other places in the States, but not in Ethiopia. Their decision, not mine. So that's all good.
Right.
But it's an amazing thing, to your question, to be taken into a building and then you see the places, it's just all locked up. And it's for researchers who come in and who can do their work, but otherwise not the general public. And then they laid out the bones in front of us on the table in trays. And you realize you're looking at somebody. And I would say somebody, she lived, she died 3.2 million years ago, but she walked upright like us. And there's a display at the museum at the end of the dinosaur display, if you want. It's the human display where we come in. And part of being human is walking upright and then some.
Right.
And we have large brains, use tools, et cetera, et cetera. But with Lucy, we start to see the beginnings of the behavior that looks like us very early still.
Right.
And that is incredible. And I will share with you that when the show was up and running, the very first days, there were, I was in the show as many times as I spent my year living in that exhibit because I loved it. And there was so much to talk about. And one of the first few days I observed and talked to two students, and I believe they were studying in Houston. I forget what school. It might have been University of Houston or Rice. Anyway, they were in school from Ethiopia. They were beside themselves because they said, back home, we cannot see her.
Yeah.
And of all things, we happened to be serendipity in the city of Houston. And they knew when they heard the word Lucy in Ethiopia, we're there. And so they were just beside themselves. And that was contagious. You know, that made me, gave me goosebumps. I had one lady who came in, she was a reporter, a journalist, and she flew in, and she really, really wanted to see Lucy. So when we start, I gave her a tour, and I said, look, I know you're here, we can see the whole exhibit, but I know you're really here to see Lucy. So if you want, we can go straight.
Right.
She was at the end of the display, as the big carrot, you know, walk through the exhibit and then see Lucy, which is against chronology, but still. I said, we can go right there, right away. She goes, no, you take me through the exhibit. And the exhibit was set up in such a way for those who didn't see it, that when you finally got to the human evolution section, you had to go through a semi-dark corridor that opened up, and then there was more light, and then there was a backlit panel, 75 feet long, 10 feet high, showing reconstructions of renderings of early hominids that had been found, early human ancestors had been found in Ethiopia. And Lucy was laid out in her sort of sarcophagus, if you want.
Yes.
And so I told her, go ahead of me, walk in, and it's your experience. She did. She immediately recognized in that particular tabletop display, if you want, that's where Lucy is. She walked up to her. She walked up to where her feet were or would have been. And she started looking at it. And she looked at me and she started crying.
That,
in those cases, you really know that it's a very powerful experience, being at the museum and see things in person. And so anyway, those are two little things I wanted to share with you about the exhibit.
I was beside myself because I'd always had an interest in archaeology, as you kind of know, and from when I was really little. And my sister gave me that book when I was 16, yes, and I just loved it. And then I took several anthropology, archaeology classes in college. And then I tried to start my master's in archaeology, but Memphis is more towards the mound builders. And I wanted to be of Egypt. Hmm. But when I read that she was going to be at the museum, I was just beside myself. And I did get to see her. So it was very, it was a very emotional exhibit.
Yeah.
So for those out there, from the time the phone rang until the exhibit opened, how many years was that?
Well, the exhibit opened in 2007. I want to say that probably we got started in 2003 or 2004.
Wow, yeah.
It takes a while.
It does take a while.
But there was definitely, for starters, as I mentioned earlier, the initiative came from Ethiopia. So it was not us saying one day, it would really be cool. Right. Yes, it would really be cool if we could do this. And then us reaching out to them. It was the other way around. And so we worked for quite a while on the story. What is it that we would like to share? And also, what is it we would like to show, right, to share that experience? And Ethiopia is 24 hours door to door. And I one day kind of looked at my watch. I pulled shut the door at home. And then when I opened the door at the hotel in Ethiopia, it was a 24-hour trip.
Right.
And I don't know nowadays if you can, I doubt it, if you can fly, you still have to stop somewhere.
Right.
It was, in our case, Houston to New York or Washington. And then from there, on the same plane, I would fly to Italy, and we would get there early in the morning, and there would be a change of crew. And we would try to sleep on the plane, but the plane was on the ground, and the crew left. And then a new crew came aboard. And then here you have Italian cleaning crews with their vacuum cleaners just up and down the aisles, you know, lift your feet.
Yeah.
Trying to sleep was interesting. And then you flew on another 4 or 5 hours from Italy all the way to Addis Ababa. So, you know, with a layover here and there, of course, in New York and in Italy, it took you 24 hours to finally get to your new place. And then we would go to the museums the next day. So we would spend maybe 14 days on the ground visiting other museums, talking to people, professors from the universities and everything. So they were the specialists, and we would lay out and ask questions. Right. But it's not like we can go up to Dallas and say, like, if it's not this weekend, we'll go next weekend. Right. It had to be planned, and people had to be available. And so that's why it took a little while. Of course, people may remember a technology called a fax. We fax the documents over there. And sometimes it would work, sometimes it would not. Overseas, and is there paper in the on the other side? Is there paper in our machine?
Do people even use faxes, like real fax machines anymore?
I doubt it. I'm dating myself. You know, I think Lucy used that.
I know. So let's step forward. And the Stonehenge exhibit, is it still at the museum?
It might still be, but it's, of course, the museum itself is closed, and the exhibit closed as well a few weeks ago. So that is no longer an opportunity for people to come see once we reopen. It was a cool show. It is a phenomenon. It's, people have heard of Stonehenge, I'm sure. It's a name that people recognize. And it came from or incorporated materials that had never been out of the UK before.
Right.
We had, and this is what made it so, in my opinion, really cool. It was very well displayed, for starters. It had modules, and so you start with the who, what, when, and where. had a cool timeline to set things up. And we do the same thing in our Egypt Hall. Stonehenge, or at least one phase of Stonehenge, was built roughly, give or take a few hundred years, at the same time as the pyramids. And so with a timeline, that point is made, and we still make it in our ancient Egypt Hall, or Hall of Ancient Egypt. And when you draw that attention of our visitors to that connection, not connection, but it's happened at the same time, people go, huh, I did not know that. And so anyway, the introduction was really good. And then it took you through time in Stonehenge, from the early days, thousands of years before Stonehenge was built. The people were doing stuff already. They were building things out of wood. And then there were artifacts associated with those early days before Stonehenge. And then eventually here you get to Stonehenge, and then the different phases, and what do we know about the stones, and where did the stone come from? So there were signs involved. There were lots of very short videos with people who studied animal remains, human remains, the geology. They would give you the 3-minute speech. It's a long elevator speech, but this is how we know what we know and share in the exhibit. And then there were mannequins, very lifelike mannequins. And they were set up in such a way, in some cases, where you turn the corner and there's a guy on his knees and he has a huge deer antler tool raised above his head because he's hacking away in the limestone because they're going to build a ditch that is part of Stonehenge. And that's what it would look like. When you turn a corner and you look at that guy and it's like, oh, wait a minute, what? Oh, he's just a mannequin.
Right.
Anyway, and so we had a number of these scenes and reenactments throughout the exhibit to make it more personable and not dry academic. This were people involved, and you had to imagine, and I tried to do this too when I took people through the exhibit, the distance between the quarries in Wales and the place where Stonehenge was built is roughly, I think, the distance between Galveston and Huntsville, but not flat.
Right.
And so now imagine all of us, a group of 50 people, pulling, pushing, shoving a stone the size of a small truck over the hills, into the valleys, across a river or a swamp or whatever, and do that many times over to build Stonehenge.
Right.
It's not like you put in an order with Amazon and it's delivered the next day. And so that exhibit, it really lends itself to what I like to call time travel.
Right.
Let's imagine being there. This is what we would have looked like. We would have worn this and that. We would have done this type of work. This is how you would make your tools. This is what you would eat. And then in addition to that, the people who studied the human bones were able to identify in some cases that people came from mainland Europe. There were waves of migrants coming through from, and they brought with them knowledge of different types of ceramics, and they were on display. They brought with them knowledge of agriculture, and that was reflected in a change in lifestyles. They were connecting so many dots, and so the stories were incredible that we were able to tell. As a guide, you as a visitor, you could weave your own story and connect your own dots, but otherwise, you know, our docents, myself, we would be able to say, and wait a minute, later on we'll see another thing, keep this in mind, because and so before you know it, you have an appreciation of a few thousand years worth of prehistory.
Was this exhibit, did you guys initiate it, or did somebody else call and say, we want you
to? It was a traveling exhibit, and it came to us, it had been on display before in Kansas.
Okay.
So this was put together by folks in the UK because it's their background, it's their backyard. And so they put it together and traveled it, and they have access to the collections. And that's why I was saying there were things in that exhibit that had never left the UK before. And these are stone tools, but you know, they're old human remains, never traveled before. So pretty cool.
It is cool. When I was in England in 1998, we went to Stonehenge one very cold morning.
Yeah. When is it not, right?
I know. And I was there for about 3 hours because we missed the bus to go back.
Oops.
I know. But it was an absolutely beautiful day. And it just looked like, I took pictures of it. When I look at the pictures just don't look real because it just looks so perfect that day.
Yeah.
It's just, it is really amazing. So we're going to start wrapping this up a little bit. And let's talk about archaeology and anthropology, and especially now going forward, can you still have a degree in those fields and still do something outside of a museum or anything like that? Like what, how can those degrees be useful in other areas than just going to excavations or things like that?
Well, that's a very good question. And I get that question asked many times, explicitly or implicitly. Mm-hmm. When my office is open, I have on a regular basis every year, students either email me first and then come in, or just call and come in, or just over the phone, I give them answers. But I always tell them, come on down. If you have time, let's sit down in my office and we'll talk and get to know each other. And what exactly do you want to do? So archaeology in the United States, as I mentioned earlier, is part of a field called anthropology. So right. It's part of the study of human beings, in this case by excavation. Other people study languages, and there's not so much excavation involved, but more like recording, I guess, right. Or you know, studying with living people. But so come on to my office and then we'll sit down and talk. And I will tell them right off the bat, if that is what you want to do, pursue it, but know this. It's not easy to find a job. Right. And I'm really lucky that I have one. Having said that, if I can do it, you can do it. And so if you want to do it, I'm not going to be the one telling you you shouldn't. So it's a very convoluted answer, but I think I want to be right. honest as well.
Right.
However, within the field of anthropology, archaeology is part of it. Yes, one can find a job in education, of course, school. That could be high school, could be college, could be postgraduate studies, graduate schools, or museums.
Right.
But as an anthropologist, you could also find work. And I sometimes point out, for example, if you're more into linguistics, if you go to here in Houston, as people may know, and those of us who live in Houston, we do know, it's a very large medical center. If you walk into some of these buildings up to the reception desk, there might be a small information sheet standing upright, little placard.
Right.
And it will say in many languages, including one of the languages from Ethiopia, by the way, if you need assistance in your language, we will find somebody who can speak that language. So that's not to say that only anthropologists can speak Amharic, because right. people from Ethiopia in Houston can do it just right. as well, if not better.
Right.
But there is a modicum of understanding that cultural anthropology, in this case, human-to-human contact sometimes involves a knowledge of cultural behavior, cultural norms. Mm-hmm. Some people might come in from overseas where a woman patient who is seeking help in Houston, because of her cultural background, might want to be seen by a female doctor right. and only a female doctor. And if the best doctor happens to be male, and the perception here is, well, then in that case, you should see the best doctor and he's available. So why don't you want to see him? There might be a disconnect, and an anthropologist can help medical people right. understand that is not something where they're not willing to go. It's just cultural.
It's a cult, yeah.
One could also find perhaps work in the State Department. There are cultural attachés mm-hmm. to represent the United States overseas and be aware of how best to convey our norms and our insights with the people in the countries that you're stationed in. So there are some places that perhaps are less traditional, but still worthwhile. And you have a broad background as an anthropologist that you can makes you flexible. Now, if you're dead set on becoming the next Indiana Jones, of course, then working in the medical center behind a reception desk is not going to get you the famous whatever it is you're looking for. But if you're interested as an anthropologist in people-to-people contact, well, we're surrounded by us.
Right.
So there are opportunities and people do find them.
I will say that my undergrad degree was in international relations. I had this far-fetched idea of becoming an ambassador to a Middle Eastern country. And I was required to take anthropology classes, whether I wanted to or not. And I will say that even though I didn't go the route of being an ambassador or in the State Department, in every job that I've ever had, it has helped me so much being able to understand different cultures and how different people's their cultural aspects of themselves, how that all interplays and how not to insult somebody and to
sometimes
be
aware, without realizing it.
Yeah, and to be aware of a lot of those things. And even when I, because I worked at an intermodal trucking company for 10 years, and we had a lot of drivers that were not born in the United States. And right. that really helped as well, just kind of more so than our other employees, it helped because I was more aware of the cultural differences.
Right.
And so, yes, it definitely helps.
And it wouldn't be that the person on the other side who is exhibiting a certain reaction is doing this out of ill will. It's just a cultural.
Right.
That's not what I do. That's not what I can do.
That's exactly right.
You would
right.
understand that.
Thank you so much for doing this.
My pleasure.
For me today. It's
good
been
to be
fun.
With you.
You know, when the pandemic hit, and I had not done my podcast for a few months because I just hadn't had time. And I started doing them again. I've actually really enjoyed them because I'm getting to catch up with people that I probably would not have had made the time to sit down and catch up with. And I haven't seen you since what, January? I think I can't remember the last time I saw you.
If not earlier. I mean, it might have been. Yeah, it's been, time goes by quickly.
It does. It does. So I thank you for spending this Saturday morning with me.
My pleasure, as they say.
And I will definitely put all your contact information and the museum's information in the show notes when we,
when you.
I get this published. So just hang on. Thank you very much. And we'll talk to everybody later.
For those wishing to connect with Dirk, you can find the Houston Museum of Natural Science online at hmns.org, as well as all of their social media channels. Dirk can be reached direct at dirk@hmns.org. I most appreciate you listening in today and hopefully learning something new as well. If you're not yet subscribed, then head on over to iTunes or wherever you listen to podcasts to subscribe so you do not miss any of the upcoming episodes. If you're feeling extra warm and fuzzy today, please share this episode with your family, friends, and anyone else that might enjoy the conversation. And please don't forget to leave us a review on iTunes. Until next time, have a fantastic rest of the day.